Finally, the first Bayonetta Iceberg video on YouTube. How are we going today, everyone? My name is Rakun. Thank you so much for clicking on this video. The original updated iceberg was created by Dazzle Pattern on Reddit. I highly suggest to support their artworks on their Instagram, link in the description. They post these mesmerizing works of art, and this video would not have been possible without them. So please support the official release before seeing my derivative work. I added some icicles that have a subtle dark gradient on them, which means they are my derivative additionals. Ranging from the tip of the iceberg to the abyss below, I have six layers all for you to consume. Without further ado, let's get right into the iceberg. Progressing smoothly. This refers to the ongoing meme that Mr. Hideki Kamiya has been frequently answering with the progress of Bayonetta 3. Though it can be argued that Nintendo being the sole publisher of the Bayonetta franchise now, it is safe to say that Mr. Hideki Kamiya is only allowed to say a very few things about the upcoming sequel. Bayonetta wears her hair. Fairly straightforward. The outfit that our lovely Bayonetta is all from her hair that magically adapts to her body shape while materializing into what looks like her outfit. Sexism controversy. An article posted on the 3rd of June 2011 by the name of Wonder Geek emphasized that Bayonetta was their least favorite character in any type of gaming ever. There is another prominent figure in this topic that I only learned recently. However, I'll leave that up to you to dig up on. Though regardless of their stance, and being designed by a woman, Bayonetta's character can be argued that she embodies humanity's empowering desire, and being oneself regardless of your origin, even literally being a forbidden child of two warring clans. Pole dancing scenes. These refer to the ending scenes, usually at the rolling credits, of Bayonetta pole dancing to either Fly Me to the Moon or Moon River ballad versions. In Bayonetta 2, her pole dancing scenes can be seen creditless. Mr. Hideki Kamiya, Block City. Though it is his account, he can block whoever he desires, including me. Bayonetta is OP in Super Smash Bros. 4. There is a whole intriguing video of this made by the Score Esports, titled How One Character Destroyed an Entire Game. It is worth the watch. Canonically 7'9". According to the wiki, Bayonetta is said to be 11.951 Umbran Witch height, which equates to about 7'9" tall. Bayo legs meme. Literally have anyone pictured at the right angle and you got yourself the best meme ever. The shadow remains cast. If the player selects yes, then the screen fades to white and the Umbran Elder's voice proclaims,
"The shadow remains cast!"
allowing the player to continue the game. Bayonetta 3 Development Limbo. A development limbo is where there is little to no news about a movie or video game. Many people speculate that Bayonetta 3 and Metroid Prime 4 are in this, though Mr. Hideki Kamiya stated that Bayonetta 3 is not cancelled and will be shown when it is ready. I personally believe him and his team. As it's only been 3 years since the reveal, I can argue that they revealed it a little too early, but maybe that was their marketing strategy all along. The daily status of Bayonetta 3. A Twitter account by the name of The Daily Status of Bayonetta 3 posts a daily status of Bayonetta 3. With the best meme, there's no news. I wonder what they will post once a new trailer drops. Umbran Witch weight. Like height, Umbran witches have their own unit of measurement. As Bayonetta is over 205 pounds, or 93 kilograms, doing some ratio maths with the numbers we've been given, we can conclude that one Umbran witch weight is equal to around 43.90 pounds, or 19.91 kilograms. Yoshesk, creative handle, Donguri990. Ask any competitive Bayonetta player on where they learned dodge offset, 99% of them will say Yoshesk. The well-known Bayonetta veterans that absolutely mastered the hack-and-slash game Bayonetta, Arguably the pioneers of Bayonetta content on YouTube, many current players have been inspired by their works on YouTube, including a certain raccoon. Radahn is a fallen angel. As depicted in his Bayonetta 2 Ultimate Form, Hierarchy of Laguna and Lemisten's book, Radahn is rumored to have been the ruler of a portion of Paradiso, although he fought an insurgency against them. Another rumor is that the rulers of Paradiso at the time feared his power and banished him to Inferno entirely. Bayonetta, Playboy collaboration. Pamela Horton cosplayed Bayonetta in her famed witch outfit and had a photoshoot for Playboy. This was in 2014. Where Nintendo collaborated with Playboy to help advertise the upcoming release of Bayonetta 2 on the cover of the 2014 October issue. 4 pages of the article were entirely about Bayonetta 2. John X Bayonetta is canon. According to Mari Shimazaki's concept arts, Bayonetta and John seem to live in the same roof. Though it's more fitting that they're bond as sisters and the last two of their clan, it's still a great fanfic to fantasize about. Mr. Hideki Kamiya also stated in a tweet that Bayonetta and Radahn have a special relationship. Whatever that means. 1411 1219. This is the number on Bayonetta and Cereza's Umbrin watch, which is an engraving of Bayonetta's date of birth. King Zero. A secret, unlockable character in Bayonetta 1 by simply completing Angel Slayer. Alternatively, you can unlock him using the cheat phone with the button combinations on screen right now, for 5 million halos. Retro Game Love Letter. This is referring to the level references of Space Harrier and Afterburner, Mr. Kamiya's love of retro arcade games. An article was made about this in 2013, and the link is in the description. Radahn is the antagonist of Bayonetta 3 theory. Having similar features, being bald, a skull-like appearance, and purple fire, many fans have theorized this to be Radahn. Though in episode 4 of our Bayonetta 3 theories, we argued that in order for this to be Radahn, it would be fitting that the second timeline's Radahn would be hunting down Cereza's. A more ruthless, despicable Radahn that changed his mind about Cereza from the second timeline. John is Joan of Arc. Though not confirmed, Joan and our real-world Joan of Arc were born in the same year, 1412. Similar to how Marvel adapts Thor from mythology to comic, this could be the same deal in the Bayonetta universe. It would be awesome that Joan of Arc is actually still alive as she was an Umbrin witch, who was also teaching high school history. Rose's Multiple Hands. A spooky character design bug where in Bayonetta 2 you can see the 3D model of Rosa. She is found to have multiple, red glowing, hands. Demo tracks. These are the music files available in the demo version of Bayonetta. A playlist is shown above or in the description. Male Bayonetta. Atsushi Inaba once joked in an interview that there could be a male Bayonetta in future games. Although this is not what I intended this point to be. I'm referring to Makaze, who is one of the only people to have covered Fly Me to the Moon Climax Mix as a male cover. His voice acting has also been recognized by Creative Handle in their collaboration video. Pandora's Paradiso. Similar to the previous icicle, Pandora's Paradiso is a musical YouTuber who posts piano and singing covers. She is one of the only YouTubers to have a piano and vocal cover of Fly Me to the Moon Climax Mix. She also stated that her cover is purely memorized, so no sheet music is currently available for public use. Cheshire. In episode 2 of our Bayonetta 3 theories, Cheshire, being the doll that little Cereza carried around and being the pet name for Luca, we theorized that it could be the name of an initial forbidden child erased from everyone's memories. He would be an older Lumen Sage who's ripped out the Lumen Sage crest from his uniform as he despises the torturous method of removing such a child. The locks of hair on the Cheshire doll could be the hair from this Lumen child. Parallel Universe Cereza Timeline. This can be referring to two interpretations, the Records of Time Cereza or the Witch with Memories Cereza. For the sake of this section of the video, the little Cereza that we raised in Bayonetta 1 was said to have now been returned to an emerged alternate timeline where Mr. Kamiya stated that another axis of time had been created. For more details on alternate Cerezas, watch these two videos that explain every Bayonetta timeline. Helena Taylor was only shown Bayonetta's design. An interview by Nintendo Players UK was uploaded where Helena Taylor talks about her audition in voicing Bayonetta in Bayonetta 1. She reveals that she was only shown Bayonetta's concept design as opposed to gameplay or lore or the script.
I auditioned for it one day. All I had was a line drawing of her and five lines. And I had 5 minutes to go and prepare for it. And I just decided to do three different kind of bold takes on her. I had no idea who she was. I didn't realize how big she'd be in my life. And I went in and I put down the tracks and then heard I got the job, which was great.
An amazing voice actress. Bayonetta Sega Happy Holidays, an adorable artwork posted in 2010 on Platinum Games' website, designed by Mari Shimazaki. It was a promotional blog post that could have been the tease of the Eyes of Bayonetta books. This holiday special graphic was a lovely sign of their gift to us for enjoying the game in 2010. Joan's breast reduction. In the Xbox 360 port of Bayonetta 1, Joan's bust size was bigger than in the Wii U port of Bayonetta 1. Mr. Kamiya pointed this out, apologized to fans, and explained that the incorrect padding was used in the 360 port. He also prefers women with small breasts. So I've been told. I don't feel he really needed to apologize. It was a marginal error that I don't believe is worth spouting hate on and an easy fix. The Bayonetta timeline is a temporal paradox. In some interpretations, the whole story between Bayonetta 1 and Bayonetta 2 does not make sense. In flashbacks and actual events like the missing Holy Glaive, a paradox occurs. In episode 40 of Bayonetta 3 Theories, we came up with an interpretation that allowed all events of Bayonetta and Bayonetta 2 to make sense, using the six-dimensional law of time travel. More timelines created allowed for a series of differing events to occur, similar to how the multiple timelines hypothesis allowed the grandfather paradox to make sense. Bayonetta 2 Combat Simplification. A lot of critics and players argue that Bayonetta 2, compared to its predecessor Bayonetta 1, had a simplified combat system. Though I can argue that the time restraints that my coaches and I talked about really confined the capability of Bayonetta 2, essentially forcing you to do cheesy, repetitive tactics in order to achieve pure platinum. Its combat mechanics, however, were simplified to cater to the growing 2013 onwards audience. I hope they solve this issue in Bayonetta 3 so that way it can appeal to both veterans and new players. Cascadian cheese. This is from my good friend Krillian, who spotted a third cheese from an unseen location called Cascadian. If the pattern follows, then this could mean that the next village we will explore in Bayonetta 3 could be the city of Cascadia. Radahn is the strongest character. According to Platinum Games and their website, Radahn is deemed to be the strongest character in the franchise so far. As said in episode 4, following the Deus Ex Machina archetype, Bayonetta 3 could be the time where he needs to unleash his full strength, much stronger than that of our secret boss fights in Bayonetta 1 and Bayonetta 2. Divine Will. A mysterious divine being that is mentioned subtly in the past two games, potentially being the entity that embodies Esir, Jubelius, and Sheba as one before the first Armageddon. Another possibility is that this is the empty shell of the three gods that still communicated with Radahn while he was still in Paradiso. The weapons would then be actual creations of the divine will. Our theory in our 50th episode suggests that this could be Lilith, regarded to be Adam's first wife in our real-world theology. Keep this in mind for later. Baldur and Rosa, with love until the end of time. This is the magical engraving in both Bayonetta 1 and Bayonetta Bloody Fate. In Bloody Fate, Rosa gave this to Bayonetta as a memento, while in Bayonetta 1, Lucas stole this from Bayonetta's room, as confirmed by Mr. Kamiya, and was used to lure Bayonetta for a photograph. In the video game series, it is possible that young Baldur snuck the lipstick into Bayonetta's room while on the verge of losing himself to Lopta. This would mean that Baldur gave Bayonetta the lipstick before he was completely possessed. Cereza's unknown voice actress. In the commentary for Bayonetta Bloody Fate, it was revealed that the English voice actress for young Cereza in the game is unknown even to developers. When attempting to rehire the cast from the game for Bloody Fate, they had no way of finding who voiced little Cereza. All that was known is that she was a 7-year-old child when she recorded, and that she would have been too old to reprise her role anyway. Therefore, Joy Gillian was hired as the new little Cereza. Ultimately, it is possible that there is a grown-up woman that was initially the voice of little Cereza still out there. It is unknown whether or not they will reveal themselves in the future. Bayonetta's Development Diary. As mentioned before, the Developer Diary is a two-part interview on the release of the Bayonetta PC port. Mr. Kamiya revealed the meaning of Bayonetta's Maul that is not in any strategy guide. This was the basis of our third episode, the Witch with Memories theory. More interesting trivia was made by Mari Shimazaki, Yusuke Hashimoto, and Atsushi Kuroka, revisiting their past memories on developing Bayonetta 1. Ask Your Mom. This was an ongoing meme for quite some time, but the most notable time was when someone questioned how he feels about Bayonetta now being on an inferior console, to which in classic Kamiya fashion replied with, "Isn't your mom disappointed with her inferior son?" This can also be a reference to one of Bayonetta's signature catchphrases. IMDb Bayonetta 3 plot leak. This made it to two of our theory videos where IMDb and a few other game stores allegedly leaked the Bayonetta 3 plot, detailing that after a daring fight with Baldur, Bayonetta and her past self must team up against this new antagonist. Although this was later debunked as YouTube user Abdel Rahman claimed to have edited the existing statement replacing Bayonetta and Baldur with John and Rosa. It is unknown who edited the first statement. Lopter was going to be a woman. In page 112 of the second Eyes of Bayonetta book, a draft for Lopter was created that seemed to have feminine features like their breasts or hips, prevalent in the female body. This was also the inspiration for our Lilith design. Though Lopter was initially meant to have both masculine and feminine features, the idea was scrapped to just incorporate a male body and elements of the people of Noatan. Perhaps they are saving a feminine, female antagonist for Bayonetta 3. Antonio Redgrave is the narrator. In Bayonetta 1, Antonio is confirmed by Mr. Kamiya to be the narrator of the world of Bayonetta, Luca in Bayonetta 2. Which, if they were to do the same, first narrator is the main antagonist like how they did in Ruby, that brings me to my next icicle. Antonio Redgrave is the purple figure, theorized by Raccoonity mod CrazyGal, mentioned in episode 45 of Bayonetta 3 Theories. As the icicle suggests, could this voice by Richard Epcar be back as the purple figure in Bayonetta 3? Crescent and Sunrise Valley statues. As showcased in our lore concept in episode 50 verse 2, the Crescent and Sunrise Valley statues are an amazing mystery. The first Umbran Witch and the first Lumen Sage are immortalized here. Shimomura live-action cutscenes. This was the amazing live-action, pre-visualization before 3D modeling of the Bayonetta 1 cinematics. Actors and actresses cosplayed and danced actual choreographed routines in order to visualize the scenes more accurately to animators. Bayonetta's original outfit was cosplayed before they remodeled it due to her hair covering the player all the time. This was also how they visualized and tracked the animation for the infamous Let's Dance Boys video. Early prototype and beta gameplay. As shown in the Shimomura cosplay scenes, this was the showcase of Bayonetta's first design. It featured intended clunky gameplay in order to draft and improve into the Bayonetta we know today. The 30-minute documentary also exhibited a different health bar and player user interface. It feels like a different game when you watch it, and as you notice, Bayonetta's hair covers her most of the time. This was then changed to her serious mode, which only appears at certain times. Bayonetta's developer's commentary. This refers to the rarely seen commentary and Q&A between Mr. Kamiya and J.P. Kellum. J.P. Kellum was the one responsible for Bayonetta's summoning language and the former English mediator for English-speaking Platinum Games fans. This is a long series where it's basically Mr. Kamiya's commentary while playing Bayonetta 1. This was where he confirmed that there was a new Axis of Time created. Lucas stole Bayonetta's lipstick and told us it's an action game. Don't think about it too hard. A unique gem of videos in Platinum Games' YouTube channel with only a few hundred views on each one. Joan is a virgin. This is to the theory. On top of Mr. Kamiya's confirmation that the mole is formed from a witch's most treasured memory, that John's mole is nowhere to be seen, insinuating that she has not had any sexual relations ever. This would be historically accurate, as there are certain several accounts that our real world's Joan of Arc died celibate. She was known as the Maid of Orleans, as maid meaning pucelle also signifies that she was a virgin, an important distinction as society deemed virginity as pure and in high regard. Though it can be argued that her mole is somewhere where we cannot see, or that she has not experienced her treasured moment yet. Possibly, it will be revealed in Bayonetta 3. Lopter was trying to save the universe. Episode 50, verse 1 explained it better. But just like Ultron and Giovanni, Lopter wanted the Eyes of the World to at least have a chance against the God of Reality, Lilith, which we theorize to be the actual second Armageddon, as teased in our Bayonetta 3 anime opening 2. Eggman the Destroyer. In the prologue scene of Bayonetta 1, Eggman the Destroyer was the first character ever revealed in Bayonetta, or introduced. One of my most well-known theories, the Potassium Butcher Theory, hypothesizes that Eggman was the purple figure in the Bayonetta 3 teaser, who has escaped from Inferno as his corrupted, fiery image reflected his aggressive persona that even Inferno couldn't hold him. Explained better in that video, you should go check it out, even though I spoiled the outcome of who the purple figure is in that upload. Aside from that theory, Eggman the Destroyer was said to have been an impulse decision by the developers. Even though it bears resemblance to Sonic's Eggman, Mr. Kamiya confirmed that this was not the case. Eggman could return in Bayonetta 3. Records of Time, The End, is the fourth darkest timeline. While some deem it to be a non-canon demonstration of what's to come in Bayonetta 2, the Records of Time, The End has been a mystery since its insurgence. Until very recently, Mr. Kamiya confirmed that this was an alternate universe, while we debunked that this could not have been the little Cereza we raised in Bayonetta 1. In the Witch with Miseries theory, episode 40, we concluded that the Records of Time, The End, must have happened in the fourth timeline. A timeline in conjunction with its name felt like the end of the world happened even before the events of Bayonetta 3. A dark conclusion to where that Cereza potentially died. Sonic All-Stars Racing Transformed, cut content. I have to thank SetNarrowX, another Bayonetta, Sega, and Platinum Games veteran for this fact. Quoting SetNarrowX, Steve Lysette, the director of the first racing game, shared details on who they wanted to get for their crossover racer, and at one point they tossed around the idea of putting Bayonetta in the game. She would be racing on the Route 666 motorcycle, and her all-star ability would have been Panther Within. This got scrapped because they feared her appearance would have raised the age rating. Baldur's story mode in Bayonetta 2. Baldur was intended to have his own story mode where we play the game in his perspective, and eventually meet up with ourselves as Bayonetta. Unfortunately, due to time constraints, this idea was scrapped and he was only playable in Tag Climax. This is why it's great that they are taking their time with Bayonetta 3. I recommend to please support them whether financially through merchandise or just by being patient, so that we can have more epic features like this in Bayonetta 3. Bayonetta Angel Land. Most commonly known as 8-bit Bayonetta, this is a 2D game that allows you, as Bayonetta, to jump and shoot as many angels as possible. You cannot move left or right. Initially published as an April Fool's joke in 2017, it was removed from Steam days after release. You can either download it a certain way on Steam or go to Platinum Games 404 error page, link in description. Not allowed to be shown without her glasses. Seeing Bayonetta with her glasses off, as said by Mr. Kamiya, is like seeing her naked. It would not be safe for work. She removes her glasses briefly in Bayonetta 1 against Temperantia to clean them, but we never see her face. Ironically, little Cereza is seen without her glasses. Therefore, it could be a Bayonetta-only antic, only affecting our Bayonetta and not the other timelines. Maybe. Just a theory. Mr. Kamiya said she wore a stern-looking mask as some traumatic things happened to her which have caused her to not show her real face. She feels safer when she can cover her face with something. Maybe that's why the empowered little Cereza that we raised in the first game is able to show her face without glasses. Though I hope we see Bayonetta all wounded and bloodied in her match against the antagonist in Bayonetta 3, with her glasses falling apart, signifying that this fight is going to be a turning point in our Bayonetta's growth. Alraon is John's mother. This theory, known as the Mandrake Widow Theory Part 2, is shown in our 39th episode of Bayonetta 3 Theories. Basically, it theorized that the woman in Alraon's entry was actually John's mother, Isabel, being a human of royal heritage. Alraon's suicide and therefore absence could explain John's juvenile tendencies, and the subconscious reason as to why she had John in her womb when she transformed. Alraon could also use Umbran glyphs, even when John wasn't absorbed. Subconsciously, Alraon sought her daughter in the afterlife after dousing herself in Mandrake poison after her husband left her. The sad part is, if this theory is true, John never met her mother, while Alraon was cursed with never having the satisfaction for realizing, "That's my daughter." Platinum Insect. In the prologue scene of Bayonetta 1, there is a beetle-like animal that flies upwards once the player visits it. I found this a few months ago when I was trying to find Eggman's grave for the Potassium Butcher theory. Although in the developer commentary, Mr. Kamiya stated that it seems our lead animator, Eijiro Nishimura, has very strong feelings about beetles. Apparently, he hid beetles in Resident Evil 4 as well. On Bayonetta, he made the beetle on his own, and I never knew about it. The first time I actually saw it was while watching someone else's Bayonetta commentary on the web. Fair enough, I suppose. This seems to be a running gag by Capcom and Platinum Games, as each of their games have a hidden beetle in them. Even Bayonetta 2 has one. Urser Flying Object. For over 11 years, the moon that Baldur destroyed had a mysterious object within it. This model was found by Bayonetta veteran Urser, uploading on Twitter a 3D model that we theorized to be an Umbran destroyer, Umbran generator, or Umbran spaceship. A Twitter user by the name of LoveRain had asked Mr. Kamiya if that object in the moon was significant, to which Mr. Kamiya replied with it being later related to future Bayonetta games. Coined the Urser Flying Object, it is still unknown what this object really is. Hear what I am reminded of. Love said the first is springtime, but the second resembles me so much. Her name is Love. The gravestone in the beginning of Bayonetta 1 had this engraving, as has been one of my biggest questions ever since I played Bayonetta, though I tease this to be the doing of the first Lemon Sage. Burying Lilith's body in episode 50 verse 2, it is unknown to who this gravestone is referring to. A future character we haven't met yet? The next antagonist for Bayonetta 3? Or maybe nothing at all? What really drew me to it, being canon, is that it talks about the first and second, which really reminded me of the first and second Armageddon. This could be a hint to where Bayonetta 3 is going, that was there since the very start. Whoever this is, I just hope we're on her good side. And that is the deep explanation of the Bayonetta iceberg. Please support the official release by @DazzlePattern and check out their awesome artworks. Again, this video would not have been possible without them. I'm Rockin', and happy theorizing.